so much for coming. My name is Chris Seaton. I'm a PhD student at the University of Manchester in the UK, and I work part-time for Oracle Labs. I'm going to be talking today about deoptimizing Ruby, about how deoptimization is the antidote to JIT compilers. Oracle wants you to know that this is just research we're doing here. This isn't a product announcement, so you shouldn't buy any Oracle stock or any product based on what you're seeing here today. It is just research. I've written a blog post which covers all the background to this. So if you want some more technical depth, there's a blog post which explains everything. I'm going to be making some performance claims about what our system can do. And this blog post provides all the really detailed scientific explanation for how we run those benchmarks and how to reproduce them for yourselves to verify our claims. So I'm working on a new system called JRuby+Truffle. It's a new open source implementation of Ruby by Oracle Labs as a research project with a JIT using next generation JVM technology and partial evaluation. It's now part of JRuby. It started off as an independent implementation, but the JRuby community have been very welcome to us, and we've now merged our implementation into JRuby. The next generation JVM technology we talk about is a new JIT compiler available in the JVM called Graal. What we've done is we've translated the hotspot JIT compiler into Java. That means we can use it as a library, and now we can control it directly from our Ruby implementation rather than having to rely on passing it bytecode and hoping it will do the right thing with that bytecode. You may have heard of different sorts of JIT compilers, such as method JITs, such as Rubinius and JRuby use. You may have heard of tracing JITs, and that's what things like PyPy and Topaz, the implementation of Ruby that's similar to PyPy, have used in the past. We're using a different technique to that called partial evaluation. Tom Stewart gave a talk on partial evaluation last year. So if you're interested in the technique we're using to compile Ruby, you can go refer to his talk. But I'm not going to talk about partial evaluation or the JVM or how our techniques work today. What I'm going to talk about instead is why is Ruby hard to optimize and what is the one thing we need to do to make it easier. So why is Ruby hard to optimize? You may have heard lots of people talking about different features of Ruby which make it a tricky language to work with. They're good features because it makes it easy to program, and that's what we care about more. But for the few people who implement Ruby, why are they tricky features? They're probably things you've seen talked about many times before. When we started implementing Truffle, we looked at a blog post by Charles Nutter on what you need to implement in Ruby before you can start making performance claims. He listed a lot of the things here, and they've also listed a lot of other people's blog posts about what's hard about Ruby. So fixed num is a big problem, big num promotion. When you have an integer and it gets very large, Ruby will automatically start using big num for you. But that means that you have to do a check every time you do some arithmetic to check if the numbers overflow. And those sort of checks quickly add up to be really, really expensive. And they add up to sort of swamp your computation. And this is a theme throughout all these things, having to check something. Monkey patching methods. If you can monkey patch a method at any time, that means you always need to continually check the method hasn't been redefined. So if you imagine for each bit of work you're doing, you also have to do some check to check that something hasn't been redefined or you haven't overflowed.
And quickly, the checks become more work than you're actually doing in terms of real work on the processor. Binding, so kernel binding and proc binding. These are frequently listed as a couple of the things which are the most hard to implement in Ruby. So kernel binding allows you to get an object which represents all your local variables wrapped up so you can manipulate it like a Ruby object. And proc binding allows you to do that for a proc or a block or a lambda or something like that which you've already got. And they make it very tricky to optimize Ruby because they mean that you can't, an implementation of Ruby can't store its local variables on the stack like C would, because you're always able to get them and modify them as a Ruby object at any time. Object space is listed as one of the things which is tricky to optimize Ruby for, because it allows you to get any live object at any time. That means you can't easily remove objects, pretend they don't exist, because you always have to be able to get a list of them for real. And in JRuby, for example, object space is disabled by default because of the cost of implementing it. SetTraceFunc, again, is disabled by default or simply not supported in some implementations of Ruby. This allows you to install a function to be called every line and every method called in Ruby. And again, that means you have to have a check every time, because you need to check, is there a setTrace function? So again, these checks become more work than you're actually doing. And ThreadRaise allows you to send an exception from one thread to another. Again, you need to keep doing checks, therefore, have I got something I should be raising in this thread? So those checks are the problem that we need to get rid of, and deoptimization elegantly solves all these problems. When we talk about JIT compilers, we talk about optimizing code. So we go from a slow interpreter, and we want to jump into fast JITted code. So that's how JRuby works, it's how Rubinius works, it's how Topaz works. All these implementations, they go from a slow interpreter, IDs, fast JITted code. Deoptimization is going the other way. It's going from your fast JITted code into your slow interpreted code. And the idea is, if we can deoptimize at any point, we can make the compiled code forget about the checks. We can make the compiled code not allocate objects, and as long as we can rely on the interpreter to have the objects there for real. So it's going the other way to JITs, which is why we talk about it as being the antidote to JIT compilation. So before we talk about stuff at a more technical level, let's provide a bit of an illustration. And I use Alice in Wonderland as an analogy here. So in Alice in Wonderland, Alice goes down a rabbit hole. She's chasing after a white rabbit. The white rabbit disappears into a room. When she enters the room, all she can see are these tiny little doors. And she wants to follow the rabbit to see where it's going. And she bends down and she can open these doors up and she can see a beautiful garden on the other side. However, she's far too large to fit through. Alice is a tall person, tiny little rabbit, and the door is designed for the rabbit. But thankfully, on a table, she finds a bottle of medicine, which is labelled Drink Me. And she very courageously drinks this bottle without knowing what it'll do, and she shuts up like a telescope, and she's suddenly nice and small. Now she can go through the door into the beautiful garden. But there's a problem. She realises the door was locked, and she's left the key for the door on the table. So now she's not able to get through. And because she's shrunk herself, she can't get hold of the key anymore to get through the door. Thankfully, she also finds a tiny little bit of cake, and that's labelled Eat Me. And she eats the cake, and she blows up again, and now she's able to get the key. But her problems continue from there, but that's where we'll stop the analogy. So relating that to deoptimization, Ruby is Alice. She'd like to go through the little door into the garden of utopia of high performance, but she's simply far too big. She does too much work. She's got all these checks. She always needs to have these objects available to really compare them and use them as real Ruby objects. The just-in-time compiler is the bottle labeled Drink Me, because if she can drink that, she can shrink down as small as possible, and then she can hopefully get through the door. But when you do that in a conventional implementation of Ruby, you leave something behind. You leave behind set trace func. You leave behind object space. And in reality, most implementations can't get that small anyway because they've got no good way of shrinking beyond those checks. So deoptimization is the solution to that in that it reverses the effects of JIT. So deoptimization is like the cake which allows you to restore back to your original size. And the idea is if you can drink the bottle of medicine at any point and you can eat the cake whenever you like, then we can make our compiled code much simpler because we can always go back to our full implementation of Ruby whenever we need to. So what does deoptimization do for Ruby? Let's talk about fixed num to big num promotion. As we said here, the problem is checks. We want to get rid of as many checks as possible. We want to make our code smaller. We want to shrink the code. And drinking this, the medicine of JIT is about shrinking it. So let's consider an example to start with. A plus B plus C. We'll assume that we know these are fixed nums to start with, perhaps because we worked it out through some sort of type specialization, or perhaps there's some sort of future implementation in Ruby where they're annotated as fixed nums. This is the code we need, a pseudo code, to add together these two numbers. First of all, we add together A and B as fixed nums, but they may have overflown. So we need to check, did that overflow? If it does, we need to redo the calculations as a big num. And then we continue with the next set of calculations, so plus C as a big num. If it didn't overflow, then we continue as a fixed num, but we need to check for overflow on plus C as well. Now, that's a huge amount of code. It's got branches in it. Processors don't like branches. A branch will often destroy any kind of pipeline you've got in a processor, even if you can predict them fairly well. And remember, if you have a language like Go or a language like C, the code you'll get when you add together two numbers is pretty much one machine instruction, add. Here, we've got literally, potentially hundreds of machine instructions. And this is why fixed num plus big num is really slow. So the solution to this, using dynamic deoptimization, is to say, we'll add the numbers together, we'll check if they overflowed, and then if they will, we'll just forget it. Everything will stop. We're not going to bother trying to handle that case. And what we do instead is we deoptimize. So that's our compiled code. If we get an overflow, we'll jump back into the interpreter, which implements all this logic, But in our JIT code, we simply implement this logic. Do the A plus B as a fixed sum. If it overflowed, deoptimize. We add C onto it. If it overflowed, deoptimize. This means you then don't have any branches, or you've got one very simple branch on each case, but you don't have any code in it. And you've shrunk your code. Literally, you've reduced the amount of code you have. And less code is pretty much always faster code. You've got a finite amount of space for instructions in a processor. They're a valuable resource. This allows us to reduce that. So that's fantastic if your code doesn't overflow, if your numbers don't overflow. If they do, isn't that really expensive? Deoptimization sounds like a really complicated thing, and it is, and it certainly isn't free. It takes quite a long time to deoptimize, on the order of many, many nanoseconds. So what happens if you frequently overflow? If you've got some code path where the numbers always overflow? Well, after we've deoptimized, back to the interpreter, the next time we can compile slightly different code. So if A plus B frequently overflows or has overflowed ever, we can now recompile with that branch in that handles that case. The other one which didn't overflow, we'll keep that as a deoptimize. So we can gradually create your, make your code more and more open to using these the different dynamic programming aspects of Ruby as it goes, but we only add them as we need them. We call this a type of specialization. And over time, your program specializes the code it needs, and each time we can deoptimize, go back to the interpreter, then when we compile again, we can include a bit more information that we need, but we're getting bigger very gradually, rather than having it all at the first place. Monkey patching methods. So whenever we have something like myObject.myMethodXY, we need to have a check. And the simplest implementations of Ruby, which have no cache or anything like that, don't need a check because they simply do the lookup every time. So the simplest case is look up my method in my object and then call it with X, Y. But any non-trivial implementation of Ruby these days will do, has the object changed? Then look up the method and call it. If it hasn't, use a cached version of that method and then call it with X, Y. But what we need to do, therefore, is each time we need to check, has the class been changed at all? Has anyone monkey-patched the methods on it? And again, this then becomes a check. So the tiny bit of code we're really interested in doing the call has, again, become swamped by all this bookkeeping and stuff like that. So we can improve that by, like we did with the overflow checks, we can say if the class has changed, we'll stop everything and we'll deoptimize. We'll jump back into the interpreter and we'll handle it there. If it hasn't changed, we'll continue and we'll use the cached method. Now, we can actually do one better here than the overflow checks. We can remove this check even further. What we can do is we can say, use the cache method and call it with X, Y, without any checks whatsoever. So we've removed all the dynamic programming, meta-programming, monkey-patching features of Ruby here to simply have, use the cache method and call it. So how do we support deoptimization here? One of the things we can do in deoptimization, if we go back to the analogy with the cake, we can force someone to eat cake from afar. So if Alice has shrunk herself, and then you realize that it's now she's shrunk herself too far and you want to stop her, you can stop her what she's doing, you can force her to feed cake, and she'll grow again. So what we do here is if somebody else monkey patches a method, they force everyone else to eat cake and deoptimize. So if your code is still running, then the method you're using cannot have been redefined. Because if they had been redefined, someone would have forced you to eat cake and you would have gone back to that interpreter code which does those full checks. But your compiled code using the fast path can be nice and slow, nice and fast like that. Binding. So the problem with binding, we said, was that it allows you to get access to your local variables at any point. So if you consider some simple Ruby code, such as these local variables where you have A is 14, B is an array of 8.2 and 3.4. The way almost all Ruby implementations represent this will be they'll have a stack. So this is the program stack with your local variables on it, A and B. A points to a fixed num. We may be able to do a little bit of optimizations with something like tagged integers to simplify that. But in the conceptual case, it's pointing at an object 14. B points to an array, which points to other numbers as well. Now, this is really inefficient because to allocate these objects, we have to call malloc. If you're calling malloc, it's thousands of times slower than actually just using registers things like that. It's really, really slow. So what we'd like to do in a really performant implementation of Ruby is to put those values directly on the stack. But the problem is, if they're on the stack, how can you get a binding of them? If we have everything allocated on the stack list and we call dot binding, or we've allocated a proc and it's gone somewhere else and been stored somewhere else and we call dot binding on that, how do we get access to these values? Well, in deoptimization, we can recreate the interpreter state. So we can recreate all those objects. What we do is we take the call stack with the local variable values on it and we pull them off the stack and put them back into the real objects. Now that sounds like real magic, being able to access your own stack, take values off it which have been optimized away. But remember, we're writing the compiler here. So the only person who puts anything on the stack is us. So we know where everything on the stack is, so we can pull it off if we want. And this is part of deoptimization. In our compiled case, we use the call stack, and in our interpreter case, we use the full objects. And when we deoptimize, as well as jumping into the interpreter, we take all the values off the stack and put them really into their objects. This means we can support binding effortlessly because we can use local variables, C-style local variables, on the stack for all our Ruby local variables, but at any point, we can take them off the stack and use them again. And anyone who's using that local variables on the stack will be deoptimized as well, and they'll start using the method, the object which represents these local variables as a Ruby object. There's a few other techniques which we can talk about using deoptimization, which we can relate to the other examples. So something like object space, the problem normally is that you can't store your Ruby local variables on the stack because you need to get access to them as objects. Like we do in binding, we solve it in exactly the same way. We deoptimize everyone. We tell everyone that whatever local variables you've stored on the stack, I want you to put them into real objects. Tell everyone to do that, and then you can enumerate all these objects. And then there's nothing stopping you using the stack for local variables because you can simply put everything back into objects later on. Set trace func, we can implement very much like monkey patching. So if we have a call to set trace func on every single line, we simply make that a method which does nothing, and we inline it. And then instead of checking whether someone's installed a new set trace func all the time, we deoptimize them if we install a set trace func. So to install a set trace func, you tell everyone to stop, you make them all eat cake, they all become large again, and they all do the explicit checks for a set trace func. So this means these features like object space and set trace func don't have any overhead. So you've been told throughout your Ruby careers that monkey patching has an overhead. Checking for overflow has an overhead. Set trace func has an overhead. Object space has an overhead. They simply don't. Checking for overflow has one little tiny overhead, which is the jump on overflow. But apart from that, these features literally have no overheads whatsoever. In our implementation of JRuby+Truffle, we have them enabled all the time. And if you did switch them off, it makes no difference to the machine code generated at all. So how do we support deoptimization? Well, there's only three things we need to be able to do. We need to recreate the interpreter stack frame, we need to jump from the JITted code back into the interpreter, and we need to allow us to force threads to do this. Now, the first two are pretty simple. Recreating the interpreter stack frame, as we said, each thread knows what's on the stack because it put it there. The compiler knows what variables it put into which stack locations, so we can simply tell it, go through your listing of what you put where and put it back onto the stack. Jumping from the JITted code interpreter, again, is pretty simple. It's not much more than a go-to. Go from this compiled code to the interpreted code. The stack's already there. You can keep executing. But I'll explain how we force other threads to do this in a bit more detail, because this is pretty interesting, and it's pretty unique in modern VM implementations. So say you've got this code. Loop do, A is 14, B is 2, A plus B. Now, that's a tight inner loop, so we'd like to compile that so it has no checks on the method add there. We'd like it to keep running without any of these checks in. What some of the implementations of Ruby do at the moment is they check a flag on every time they loop, should I deoptimize at this point? So if you wanted to redefine add, or if you wanted to raise an exception in this thread, they have to keep checking this flag again and again. And checking that flag takes this from something which is a tight operation, which just uses local variables, or probably just uses registers, to something which accesses shared memory. And that's got implications for things like concurrency, for your caches, everything like that. Suddenly it's gone to a shared memory operation where it was really simple before. So we could implement it like this. We could say deoptimize if someone set this flag. What we actually do in the JVM is we use something called a save point. This is a fantastic trick. What we do on each loop is we read a location in memory. That's all we do. We simply read it. When we want it to deoptimize, what we do is we change the permissions on that page of memory to cause a seg fault. So what we effectively do is we cause your thread to crash And then from that point, we can reconstruct the state and keep going. So effectively, when you use a safe point, when you redefine a method, when you use thread place, raise, what we do is we cause your thread to crash by causing something very much like a null pointer exception. And that's really simple to do. It's simply one instruction, read. These safe points, as we call them, are already in your code because they're necessary for GCs. You may have heard about garbage collectors doing a stop the world collection. Well, to stop all the threads, you need to tell them to stop somehow. So we have these safe points, which allow us to do that by changing these page permissions. So we've already got these safe points in. So this is how this can be zero overhead. Because we already have these safe points to support GC, we can reuse them to do method redefinitions, set trace func, object space, stuff like that. So all modern implementations of Ruby, apart from MRI, use deoptimization to some extent, more or less. But JRuby+Truffle uses deoptimization more pervasively and more aggressively than any other implementation in Ruby, and actually more aggressively than a lot of implementations of other languages, such as the V8, such as SpiderMonkey and systems like that. So we're presenting a new implementation of Ruby here. How do you know I don't just have a toy implementation which doesn't really implement Ruby? And that's a really legitimate concern. I know in the past we've had some questions raised about other implementations of Ruby, how much of Ruby they actually implement when they start talking about performance. So I'm just going to take a couple of minutes to convince you that we have a real implementation of Ruby here. First of all, we support 86% of the Ruby spec language specs. That's provided by the Ruby spec project. We're very grateful for them providing that code. So the general language features, we do support the vast majority of them, and we're closing the gap on getting to 100% pretty fast. We don't support the same level of specs on the core library, but that's something that's just a case of implementing more libraries. It's not a case of new language features. If there's a language feature which someone thinks will impact our performance and we haven't implemented yet, we'd love to know about it, and we'll stop everything and we'll implement that language feature right away. So we've used things such as Charles Nuss's list of difficult things to implement before you start talking about performance. We've gone through them systematically. If anyone else has anything else they think we should implement before we start talking about performance, we will do. We implement all these difficult parts of Ruby. Method invalidation, dynamic programming such as send, method missing, stuff like that, binding, threads. We have initial support for C extensions, frame local variables, object space, regular expressions, encodings, eval, concurrency, debugging, closures, promotion, all those things. And actually, some of those we implement better than the other implementations of Ruby. So as I said, our object space is always on. Our set trace func is always on. We have a debugger, which is always on. You can always stop our programs, introspect them, using a shell, and then continue running at the same performance. Our support of threads is a little bit limited in that it only provides concurrency at the moment. We have a global interpreter lock, but we actually recently took on a PhD student to work full-time at looking at that, so we hope to have some progress on that soon. Our support for C extensions is also pretty minimal at the moment. We're starting to look at making that more featureful, but we run them much, much faster than any other implementation of Ruby. We actually interpret C code when you have a C extension. We interpret it using the same system we use to interpret Ruby. The big question you're going to ask is, no, we don't run Rails yet. And we're not likely to run Rails for another year or so, probably. So no one here is going to be able to use JRuby+Truffle to do anything at the moment. And we're not proposing anyone should try and do it. It's a research project. That's all it is. The rest of the JRuby community are working on other implementation techniques in Ruby which are relevant to what we need today. This is a research project and we don't run Rails. However, we are working towards it. Do I think that we'll actually provide any performance increase to Rails? Well, let's think about what Rails does and why it makes it slow. It does lots of things like dynamic programming. It uses method missing. It uses send, respond to, and stuff like that. And it also uses lots of little objects all the time. Well, actually, JRuby+Truffle is awesome at that sort of problem. If you have lots of objects, we can allocate them on the stack instead of on the heap because we can always go back to the heap if we need them. JRuby+Truffle can inline through method missing, through send, through respond to, because it can always de-optimize and go back to the full interpreter if it needs to. So actually, I think there's lots of promise for Rails. Rails isn't something that might trip us up. I think Rails is something we'll be surprisingly effective. So let's talk about performance. As I said, the blog post backs this stuff up. You can recreate our experiments if you'd like to. Please do. So first of all, you compare it against some classic benchmarks. These are the benchmarks that language implementers use, computer scientists use. So they're very well understood. And the reason we use them is because everyone in our community understands them. But they're not representative of real Ruby programs. But we'll start with them. So on something that's highly numerical and highly computation intensive, such as Fanco Redux or Mandelbrot, Mandelbrot is a fractal generator, we can be up to 35 times faster than MRI. And JRuby and Rubinius are only about twice as fast on that sort of highly computationally intensive stuff. I also show on this graph Topaz, which is the PyPy implementation of Ruby, which was started a couple of years ago now. It's gone quiet. I don't think there's any recent development on that, but we can compare against Topaz as well. Having Topaz is really good, actually, because it shows that our numbers aren't absolutely out of nowhere. Topaz is achieving something vaguely similar. On some benchmarks, we don't do any better than anyone else, really, such as binary trees and pi digits. These are very much memory-bound benchmarks, and we can't allocate memory faster than anyone else magically, so we're limited on those. Those are synthetic benchmarks, as I said. They're not really representative of any Ruby code, so let's talk about some real code. We've been using two Ruby gems over the last few months, ChunkyPNG and PSD.RB. ChunkyPNG is an implementation of the PNG file format in pure Ruby. PSD.RB is an implementation of the Photoshop file format in pure Ruby. This is production code written to make money for a business. It's real Ruby code that people are using in production today. We're very, very grateful to the authors of these gems for writing this code in the first place. On these real-world gems, we took the kernels of them. On average, we are 10 times faster than MRI. And JRuby and Rubinius are no faster than MRI on these. That's because these are highly computationally intensive work. This is about decoding images. It's about applying filters to images. If you call malloc in one of these benchmarks to allocate something like a temporary array, you've already lost. So you need to have deoptimization to be able to remove those allocations. You need to have deoptimization to have highly efficient implementations of the basic operators like add and multiply. And if you don't have those, you're never going to be any faster than MRI. And again, we're also a lot faster here than Topaz. That's because our ability to deoptimize is well above what Topaz can do at the moment. I'll pick out a few benchmarks and show where this 10x figure comes from. So if we look at some example benchmarks, on some of them, we can be up to two orders of magnitude faster. So Chunky Operations Compose takes one image and composes it on top of another. And if there's no filter there, it's effectively doing memory copy. And if you've got deoptimization, you can get rid of all the temporary intermediate arrays and hashes and method calls and monkey patching that goes into that, and you can simply write pretty much the same thing you'd get if you wrote memcopy in C. Clamp is a really good example. It clamps a value between two extremes, so sort of min, max. And they implemented this in this library by creating an array with the values in, sorting it, and taking the middle value. And with deoptimization, we can actually allocate that temporary array on the stack, and then we can trace the values simply through as registers all the way through to where they're used. So this is the sort of thing Rails does, isn't it? It allocates little tiny arrays, little tiny strings, keeps using them. If we can allocate those away, we can do much better than other implementations can. So I think that deoptimization is the single most important optimization there is in Ruby. If you apply deoptimization, you can get rid of everything that makes Ruby slow. You can get rid of the overflow checks. You can get rid of the monkey patching. You can get rid of the temporary data structures which clog everything up. Any implementation which wants to look at creating a high-performance version of Ruby, and Matt is talking about making a JIT for MRI, if you want it to be high-performance, then you need to look at using deoptimization. And deoptimization is the key optimization to make. It's not simple to implement, though. We're only able to use it because we've got the massive power of the JVM behind us. Implementing it for a simple implementation, I understand, is pretty much not as tractable. JRuby+Truffle builds on a lot of other projects. So we're very grateful to JRuby for taking us into their repository, and we use their parser, the implementation regular expressions, the implementation strings, everything like that. Of course, we depend on Ruby itself for the definition of the language, and we're starting to use the core library implementation from Rubinius. So JRuby+Truffle is taking what's best from the other implementations and is bringing it together with a really high-performance JIT core. The other thing Truffle depends on is the team which make the Graal compiler at Oracle and JKU University in Linz. So there's a lot more people that work on it than just me here. That's my Twitter handle. As I say, if you want more information about this, I've written a really detailed blog post. So if I've covered over anything today, if I've given you a simple summary of what we're doing, all the hard details are there, and you can rerun those benchmarks for yourself, you can look at the performance yourself. And as I said, it is just a research project. You won't be able to buy it anytime soon. Thanks very much. Does anyone have any good questions?